PopCap, despite its current state, is a truly global brand. What does that mean? I covered PopCap in a previous video. There, I discussed how the tiny webgame studio started by three guys was so important to the 2000s internet. If you want the full story, go watch that one before this one. They are two parts of the same tale. The only fault in that video is overlooking the post-EA acquisition PopCap of the 2010s, since, once the founders left post-2011, that was no longer the 2000s PopCap of yore. I had no interest in EA's attempts to take the studio international. Then I stumbled over something far more surreal, a parallel tale to PopCap's English popularity. I approached PopCap through a Middle American perspective, but this one goes international, into Asia and beyond. It does not start until around the mid-2000s though, but it continues to today. PopCap's international reach is far more noteworthy than first thought, if even more bizarre. PopCap's games have always been international, if not legally. In the original video's comments, a huge amount of people remembered CDs with cracked copies of PopCap games on them, basically bootlegs that circulated through schools and friend groups, in places where internet speed or technology lagged behind, or games were just not allowed. These discs were as good as gold, good enough to kill an hour. Plants vs. Zombies, Insane Aquarium, Zuma, and Feeding Frenzy all circulated on these discs. Remember, this was long before the corporate mass piracy panics of the 6th and 7th console generations. Even in Asia, they were extremely popular, but that comes up later. What about that last game, Feeding Frenzy? For a PopCap game, it was fun, but middling. Nothing amazing. Still, plenty of people remember both Feeding Frenzies and look back on them with occasional nostalgia. Plenty of people remember it offhandedly. Often on impulse, they will search up gameplay videos of the fishy fun. Some Feeding Frenzy videos have millions of views off nostalgia alone, an almost disproportionate amount of views. There, they generally stop, but I did not. I kept digging deeper and deeper into the algorithmic depths. Then, by pure accident, I stumbled across it, or more accurately, them. Beyond the gameplay, there were mods, basically unknown and untouched by outsiders. Yes. Feeding Frenzy mods circulated nearly exclusively on YouTube videos, a tight-knit underground community of modders. People developing mods for a 10-year-old web game off a cracked Chinese copy of it. Yes, it goes deeper. This conspiracy goes international. Time to take a dip into this trench. What is/was Feeding Frenzy? Well, as the name suggests, it is about fish. The original was not actually developed by PopCap. The first Feeding Frenzy, published on February 11th, 2004, was developed by a small studio named Sprout Games, an obscure little group that was acquired by PopCap in 2005, after which Feeding Frenzy 2, Shipwreck Showdown, was published February 6, 2006. Feeding Frenzy 2 was developed on PopCap's in-house engine, PopCap Games Framework, otherwise known as Sexy App Framework. Feeding Frenzy is pretty simple. The player devours other fish to grow to devour bigger things, a common gameplay loop, growth. The desire to get bigger made Feeding Frenzy pretty addictive, though it lacked replayability. As is obvious, Feeding Frenzy had limited growth. Sprout Games was absorbed into PopCap after acquisition in 2005. Feeding Frenzy 2 was a fully PopCap production. The last game was developed literally more than a decade ago, though Feeding Frenzy 2 was released on the PlayStation Network on March 11th, 2010, but the franchise has been officially dead in the water since 2006. Not to say Feeding Frenzy was bad or boring, it was far from original, but it was another solid PopCap title, and usually sits at the 4th or 5th position in most people's lists of the best PopCap games, if they remember it. Sink or swim. There is little to say about Feeding Frenzy's background. Nothing fishy for sure. Sprout Games was a small studio when PopCap bought them out. It is pretty much impossible to find anything of substance on them that does not mention the PopCap acquisition. It was apparently founded by Ed Allard, who became a senior producer at PopCap. The only name of interest that shows up is managing director James Gwertzman, who became director of business at PopCap after Sprout Games was bought out. Remember that name. Feeding Frenzy's future was tied to his. Feeding Frenzy, and thus Sprout, were nominated for Billboard's 2004 Web/Download Game of the Year. So, even before PopCap, it did have a reputation. These waves were what got PopCap and fans interested. Fans who remain after Sprout and PopCap have gone away. Yes, Feeding Frenzy has a dedicated fan base a decade later. It is small, but surprisingly active. Just not in English. I've stumbled across it researching the original PopCap video. If one digs into the YouTube algorithm on Feeding Frenzy, one hits it eventually. Or, more accurately, hits Feeding Frenzy 3, the Marianas Trench of both incredibly odd and entrancing content. The Feeding Frenzy modding community? A modding community exists for a decade-old webgame? Yes. Here those words make sense. On the surface net, there is little to no information on it. No mention on ModDB and only one obscure Reddit post. Feeding Frenzy 2 and PopCap's sexy app engine have modding documentation, but not much substantial work. Some of these videos have an upward of tens of thousands of views, brought by people randomly googling Feeding Frenzy 3 and finding them or from somewhere else. There is not much to go off. Not any language I know. Most of this is based off observation. The only information I could scrape together is from scrambled comments, video descriptions, and that Reddit post. It is incredibly fascinating. One immediately gets the sense of Chinese bootlegs, which many comments mention, but these are mods. The game edits make use of a cracked Chinese copy of Feeding Frenzy 2, as the original release of Feeding Frenzy 2 in English was considered unmoddable. Where did the mods and modders come from, though? Look east. It is both maddening and miraculous. A group dedicated to modding a decade-old webgame, then sharing mods through obscure YouTube videos? It feels unreal, but seeing is believing. There is more than enough to see. Hundreds of these videos on mods. Granted, there are some limitations. Parts of the game, like the map, appear to be hard-coded. New models also appear to be hard to import. One needs to use Theora, a decade-old software. It also has a fish. But, according to the Reddit post, model colors can be changed in engine. Fishy? Yes. Interesting? Incredibly. All existing in obscurity, in English at least. Examining the videos as an outsider is more than enough. There is a surrealism to them, an ancient web game being brought back to life by modders, a game not even listed on PopCap's website anymore. The sort of ragtag assortment of copied, unique, and outright stolen assets just adds to the dreamlike charm, a bizarre quality to the entire thing. There is a lot of effort for very little feedback. As of this video, only one or two of these videos have more than 200 comments. Not all in English either. Fascinating. It seems the group/circle only communicates through comments too. On the English internet, there is little to no footprint, an underground modding scene hidden deep within YouTube. Most of the modders are obviously Chinese. It is possible the entire thing is just spillover from a Chinese social media group, either from the websites Baidutiba or Runrun, explaining why these mods have no presence on the English internet. The group seems to have sprung up around 2016, so rather recently. None of these videos are older than 2016 either, so this seems to support the theory. What are these videos anyways? If one swims about in this odd sea, they see several names and channels consistently pop up. The biggest one seems to be a channel called Deep Dive with over 3,000 subscribers and over 2.5 million views. Why so many views? Deep Dive's mod videos get over 10,000 views and higher per video, but the most watched video is titled Feeding Frenzy Custom Level Hungry Shark World. Hungry Shark, a game by Ubisoft, is a sort of spiritual successor to Feeding Frenzy as far as I can tell. It is a popular phone game, so that may explain why so many views. Deep Dive's mods, though, seem to be the most professional out of the lot, as professional as one can be in the realm of Feeding Frenzy mods. Deep Dive has developed both Chinese, South American, and other Total Conversion mods, all with unique fish and graphics. The algorithm seems to feed most people looking for Feeding Frenzy content toward this channel. The second, with over 700 subscribers, is Legend Video. This channel does link to a Baidutiba, a Chinese social media service page for Feeding Frenzy, or, as the game is called in Chinese, Swallowfish. Baidutiba is basically a social media forum where people establish fan pages, in Chinese. Other fans from mainland China can join in on the conversation there. Why is the Feeding Frenzy page important? Because it is still active and somewhat popular. Baidutiba is where most Chinese citizens trade digital copies of Western media such as shows, movies, and games, so it doubles as a fan site and a pseudo-piracy service, if one can be a pirate in China. Most would find their game download here, and also the mods. This is probably where all the mods spill over from into YouTube. Now, I cannot read Chinese. Not even simplified. So this is just guesswork. There are definitely threads discussing the game and mods on the page. Legend Video, and others, are then likely members of this community, from where they take Chinese mods and share them with an international audience on YouTube. The language is Chinese, so the link should be more than obvious. For years after release, Feeding Frenzy 2 was considered unmoddable. That was until the Chinese version came along. The cracked Chinese copy I mentioned earlier. The Chinese, as it turns out, are really good at cracking games. the Chinese version of Feeding Frenzy 2, it might not even be an official Chinese release. Chinese fans slash unofficial localizers are legendary for translating and adapting games better than official studios in the country. For all I know, this could be a fan conversion of the English version of Feeding Frenzy 2 into Chinese. Though, as far as I can tell, I think it is official, maybe? Either way, already popular in the United States, Feeding Frenzy, like most PopCap properties, acquired a strong fan base in Red China, who proliferated the game and mods in both China and on YouTube is unknown to me. Nor is it entirely clear how it got to YouTube, as YouTube is supposedly banned in mainland China. A modder simply could have used a VPN, just like NordVPN, which you can— nah, not an ad. Not in the People's Republic. It is also possible a Taiwanese user could have discovered the Chinese copy, then spread it outward from East Asia, so there are several possible answers. So someone, somewhere in Eastern Asia, is responsible for all of what followed. The cracked copy and videos made it to YouTube, where it gained a small but remarkable following, one from all around the world. It spread out from there too, comments mentioned from being all across the world. Why Feeding Frenzy 2 though, and why from the People's Republic of China? Well, because Feeding Frenzy 1 is much harder to mod. Feeding Frenzy 2 runs on the Sexy app, which was PopCap's engine for most of the 2000s. Also, piracy is commonplace in China. The Chinese like web and mobile games. They are quick and cheap and often pirated. PopCap, being the princes of web games, are still extremely popular in China, so Feeding Frenzy is no surprise. It can easily get past Chinese censors as well. It is a very much take what you can get situation. When you cannot access what the rest of the world has, you get what you can get. Mods pretty much fix all the issues with Feeding Frenzy anyways. It adds replayability and a randomness factor. People love them. A lot of people too. On these videos, the comments are the most interesting part. They try to be as helpful as they can, but there's a very large language gap. Some comments are not even in English. There's Russian, Arabic, what I think is Thai, and of course, Chinese. Simplified or not. The countries and continents mentioned range from China to Indonesia to South America to even Southeastern Europe, a global community spanning a dozen countries, all built up around a cracked Chinese copy of a decade-old web game most have forgotten about. But wait, there's more, much more. Remember this guy, James Gertzman, the previous director of business at PopCap? He is partially related to this madness. I joked about PopCap Shanghai in the previous video, but there's a reason that studio exists, and Gertzman is partially behind it. Basically independent, PopCap Shanghai exists because of PopCap's unique popularity in China. PopCap was popular in the PRC before the studio was even established there. Gertzman delivered the entire story in a slideshow at Login 2009. I have no idea what that is. I will summarize best I can. Already extremely popular in the People's Republic due to cracked copies, Gertzman researched establishing a Chinese branch of PopCap from 2005 to 2007. The whole purpose was to create a game studio in Asia for Asia. Also to exploit China's expanding market and get around the nation's draconian international licensing policy. In 2007 and 2008, PopCap was licensed and established in Shanghai as an independent studio, though it was not really sustainable until 2009 and did not generate a profit until far later. The purpose was to get ahead of the market anyways. As stated, the Chinese do not like paying for games. Why all this effort? Just to fight cracked game copies? No, not really. PopCap acknowledged, like many others, cracking down in China is pointless. Plugging a leak there causes 10 others. The purpose was to adapt and profit in China, develop and sell games for a Chinese marketplace. And it worked. The Chinese love, Plants vs. Zombies. Why do the Chinese love premium web and mobile games? Consoles were basically banned in the country from 2000 to 2015. Kinda, that's its own story, but that's the gist of it. PC gaming though? That was not. Instead, after the government closed down arcades in 2000, internet cafes flourished, most Chinese citizens being unable to afford a PC at home in the early days. The gaming landscape in China is based off PCs and internet cafes. Until 2019, the Chinese government even ignored banning or censoring Steam, so in a country with strict social control, online was an oasis. At the same time, in the 2000s, PopCap were kings of the English internet. It only took time for the PopCap boom to hit China through cracked discs and downloads. The games were massive in China before the company was even officially launched there. Of course, PopCap never saw a cent, or yuan, from the pirated versions. Not that Chinese players had a choice either. Like all countries, China has its own unique marketplace. A really unique marketplace. A green, shambling one. China likes Plants vs. Zombies. China really likes Plants vs. Zombies. China really fucking likes Plants vs. Zombies. 2 hours after Plants vs. Zombies 2 was released in New Zealand, pirated copies appeared on Chinese websites. 24 hours, cracked copies. PVZ is a phenomenon in China. To children, it is the second most known gaming brand behind only PlayStation. Still, it reaches all age groups. Entire families are addicted to it. PopCap has a brand deal with the Chinese clothing company, Meter/Banwei, for exclusive PVZ swag. There's an unofficial card game too. Pokemon or Yu-Gi-Oh? No. PVZ. China has its own Plants vs. Zombies marketplace. It is marketed quite well in the PRC. Bootlegging is just a fact of the market in China. Western companies generally make little money there. This is due to being unable to adapt to Chinese tastes and just the economic environment. There, pirating is literally always easier than buying official. Most risk-averse businesses generally avoid the market. Not PopCap. The Shanghai division only recently started turning a profit due to microtransactions, though. The region was buttressed up by sales from Australia, Japan, and Taiwan. And PVZ? In China, it is not a one-time buy-and-play. It has a lot of microtransactions. If anything, Chinese players prefer this model. This led to quite the profit from PVZ in China, enough to basically establish a unique identity for the game/brand in China, as players kept paying for it. PopCap Shanghai has adapted/localized PVZ for China a great deal, the most interesting aspect being the country-exclusive games. Plants vs. Zombies Great Wall Edition, which is a total rehaul of the game for China, which sets it on the Great Wall of China. You can only get it in China, though. Then PVZ 2 had its own exclusive Chinese Kung Fu level. The Chinese social media site RenRen also has an exclusive Plants vs. Zombies social game as well. There's Chinese exclusive ads and everything. These are only in Chinese. I could find no English versions of them. The Chinese market is independently profitable enough to target it with just this one game. Plants vs. Zombies is basically a government-certified social movement in China. Plants and Fish, once again, why? Both games can easily get by China's notoriously arbitrary social and business censors. Even in the USA, PopCap's games are inoffensive. In China, they are probably a godsend, if I can use that word for China, for a panopticon government that does not have to care about fish or zombies. Wait, are they even no subversive morals or propaganda here, comrade? Just fun. PopCap. So they survive in their own unique ways across the world, even if strangled beneath EA or the Chinese government. The Finns of the Feeding Frenzy modding community lend me down currents both wonderful and woeful. I learned a lot about web games in China. What a weird combination. Even in the depths of YouTube, or on a website across the world, there is always something to find. Like digital fishermen, one has to ship out to the far horizon or deep trenches to find something. A little legwork is needed beyond sites like YouTube, Reddit, Tumblr, 4chan. Dig? Is that website still a thing? Or Twitter, where you can follow me for more bad fish puns. But down there, in the under net, there's the big one. Take your hand and grasp those aquatic tentacles, because, as they say, that is not dead which can eternal lie. It simply sits, dreaming stranger and stranger dreams of digital irreality. Down there, that is where the fishies or the subversives roam free, a squamous aquatic people.